Hi, I'm a professional editor and I've always wanted to expand my horizons by talking to other editors and sound designers, music composers, visual effects supervisors, essentially all the magicians who silently and invisibly work behind the scenes. This series is an attempt to make the invisible artists visible. I hope you enjoy the conversations.
Hi, Charu, and thank you so much for coming in for this long pending conversation.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Antara. And congratulations on Tooth Pari also.
Thank you so much. First of all, I really want to appreciate the body of work that you have created around you for yourself over the last several years. I want to just start with really picking your brain on how you reached there. Because I'm sure that's a question a lot of people have on their minds. So can you tell me a little about how you kind of reached FTII? Was there a thought in place? Is this a career move or, you know, is this something you just wanted to explore?
You know, you were, of course, my senior in FTII. So, I mean, yeah, like right now I can create a great story about how I always wanted to be a filmmaker or this was my calling and that's like how I reached FTII. I think when we were applying for FTII, my batch joined in 2006, right? And you were a few, 2 years senior to me. I think we were still not the Google generation yet, right? So, I would say that some of it purely happened by chance. Some of it was obviously an intrinsic interest in films, but it wasn't such a well-chartered, you know, journey, like milestone by milestone to reaching FTIS. So I'll give you a little background. So I studied in this phenomenal school, Krishnamurti Foundation School. So somewhere, I think, I can call it the beginning of the journey because it wasn't one of those schools, you know, where marks and numbers were of utmost importance. So, you know, we used to have, it was a very, very generous kind of a school as far as Indian standards of normal school goes, right? And I remember, it is going to sound really silly, but that was the first time I got this idea, which was to become a journalist. So it wasn't to become a filmmaker first or an editor.
Right.
I wanted to become a journalist first, you know. And I think that was the time when everybody was super impressed with Barkha Dutt. You know, it was that time, right? Like everybody was really impressed with Pranay Roy, Barkha Dutt, as far as, you know, we go as students. So the first thing I did, the only window that kind of appeared in front of me was to go to Delhi University and to study journalism, right? Parents go, obviously, for them, my parents were obviously very kind, but they didn't know anything. So there's always the fear of not knowing. So they were like, they close, you know, if you want to explore. So they actually put me on a train to Delhi, literally all by myself. After class 12, they just put me on a train.
Where were you though?
Studying in a boarding school, Rajghat Besant School in Varanasi.
Okay,
so they put me on a train literally after my 12th exam. And I was a PCM student. So obviously for them, it felt like I'm going to give engineering and all. So I was a PCM student who scored the maximum in economics. So I was that student who was not interested in PCM. So they were like, okay, you know, she'll go and like, ye sab sab cheeze, you know, she'll forget. So they put me alone on a train to Delhi, and my cousin was living there. He was studying in DU. So he told me, ye North Campus hai, ye South Campus hai, or explore. So I was like, okay, what do I do? So I started applying to colleges, and there were very few colleges which offered journalism back then in Delhi University. So one such college was Indraprastha College for Women. So just like entrance test tha. So I thought that, you know, this could be my chance because otherwise DU percentages go like really high, like SRCC. And so I applied for the entrance for IP College for Women and got through. I think that was the point when more, I would say, defined ideas of filmmaking started evolving. Uske pehle it was only journalism. I wouldn't even say that one entirely new production or television production. You know, all one knew was this new face of journalists that had bombarded Indian television, right? So it was then during mass communication that, you know, we had some teachers from Jamia who used to come, and Jamia had a full-fledged film course going on, right? Is when one started realizing that, you know, there are departments and there are things one can pursue. And there were a few seniors from IP College who had gone to FTI earlier. So I think they kind of paved the way into opening up this new world. Film school is also an option. You know, is also an option. And that is, I think, post actually the mass communication, after my mass communication post was over, that I applied for FTI right after it. And and I got through.
So it is a bit of almost a trial and error in a sense for a lot of us, I think, because films and filmmaking hadn't kind of exploded as a career option as it has now. Because I think now a lot of people even sign up for film school with a very clear career path, right?
Yeah. I think, you know, when we were, now imagine, we were growing up when, like the majority of our growing up happened in the 90s, right? And by the 2000 to 2006, we were already in, say, graduation and FTI. So I think at that point of time, filmmaking was not a career option. So I don't even know how our parents allowed us to explore it. I'm curious. I must ask them. But I don't know how we actually landed there. It's quite miraculous, to find that path. And sometimes when I look back now, I feel like it would only be destiny that would put us on this journey. Now, in fact, youngsters, and it's filmmaking is much more democratic now, right? Everybody is a filmmaker. You know, and so hence, you know, for someone deciding that this would be their career option, I think is a much easier choice today than it was for us back then. And I also think that none of us possibly approached it from the point of view of career. I would say we just landed there to have fun. And I think a lot of our evolution happened in FTI.
That's true. And I think it was a kind of a space for a lot of introspection for a lot of us. And to really look at it as a, you know, it's sort of like a little digression that you make in the course of your, almost a journey, you know, in a sense. Right. So I'm almost like, I'm very intrigued by people who get in with that career, you know, thing in mind. But do you feel like now, let's say, if you were now kind of at this point, figuring if you want to do a film school course, would you go back?
And choose to do a film
and choose
school
to do a
course?
Film course?
And versus not doing it?
Versus now, like directly, you know, there's so many jobs
right.
so much more access, like editors are there on social media, you can just message them and ask for jobs. So there's so many avenues open and available now. So would you still, if you were you, but in slightly different, in a different context,
course,
which is now. Would you still kind of make that choice?
This debate is actually quite interesting because statistically, there is no way to prove whether a film school or a person who's gone to a film school would have a successful film or otherwise, right? A person who has not gone to a film school, you know, would not have a successful film career. And unlike a lot of other professions where you really need to study. So, you know, just like life has no formula, I also think filmmaking has no formula, right? There's no way to land there. But having gone to a film school, I would choose it all over again. And I'll tell you the reason why I say that, Antara, is that, you know, we are already a hustle culture. Our nation, or all developing nations, we're already a hustle culture, right? We've always been fed that idea from our parents, from our colleagues, aage badho, you know, like move ahead, right? the moment you get the luxury, which is why I said that FTI helped us evolve, and maybe other film schools also, just the luxury of being a student, you know, where you can fail, you can falter, you can experiment, you know, you can have fights, or you can literally just do nothing. And without worrying that there is a you know, hustle to have, or you know, or somebody to answer, right? I think that luxury in itself is a great luxury to have. If you have the choice, why not be a student? You know, and not only that, I think it also provides you with important tools. At least from where I come from, I don't think if I had not gone to a film school, I don't know how I would have gotten my hands on such expensive equipments. Like now, of course, like I said, filmmaking is much more democratic, right? So you have editing softwares on your laptop, you have cameras on your phone. What did we have back then? How would we have shot anything? Or even found a way to, you know, like to access the amount of cinema that we watched. If I speak for myself, if I hadn't gone to FTI, I don't know how, you know, eventually one would have seen so much and learned so much. So I think, you know, if resources allow you, because it's also about resources, if resources and time allow you, film schools are always a great choice. And also the third thing is to hang out with, you know, such fertile minds, right? You know, who have a shared journey, and a lot of, you know, like people from film schools knowingly or unknowingly have this shared bond because they've just, you know, it's like a journey we are all in together, and it makes you feel less alone because this journey is arduous. So I really team film school. But having said that, if one does not want to, it's not like one cannot become a filmmaker, because filmmaking cannot be taught, you know, in a film school, right? So, you know, you can still read, you can still travel, you can still listen to music, and now so much material is accessible online about filmmaking, and you have so many tools within your reach that if one is able to find their way out using those resources, then, you know, even that is possible. So yeah, I feel like there is no one route to it. I'm an advocate of this.
So it's interesting that you mentioned hustle, because that is kind of what my next question to you is. Do you feel like one has to be really good at kind of hustling alongside having the talent or the skill for the job? How important is hustle, and like, do you feel like it's a bit disproportionately high currently with the current crop of people, that the hustle is kind of higher than the level of skill?
So in a way, I think hustle in the right proportion is needed for anyone, and that means people who are skilled, that means people who have gone to film school, people who have not gone to film school. Any which way, you need amount of hustle. Also because, you know, film industry is not a place where you go to a company, you know, you go to GlaxoSmithKline and you give your resume to an HR and, you know, you get a call, right? So you are going to have to hustle and find your way to meet people, to approach people, to make yourself hireable. So you have to do those, long walks. But having said that, if hustle is your primary skill, if that's your primary skill, if you think that that's your primary skill and the other skill sets are much, much lower, yes, you may land your first few jobs, you know, because there is, of course, demand and supply at play here, right? So you may land a few jobs, but I think it will be skill in the long run, which will really be your strength. So I think hustle without skill and skill without a little hustle are both useless. It should just be the right proportion of both.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. I completely agree with that. I think something that this is very important, especially for a younger lot of people who are assistants, for instance, to really understand that. And that's where they are kind of fumbling a lot, because I think, again, we were talking about this a bit, that very often you'll find people who have just assisted, say, on one film, and they're ready to kind of move on as an associate almost immediately. And I feel that is a very, very risky maneuver, because every film and every project, every series comes with its share of problems, which are very unique to it. So you do need a certain amount of, you know, exposure to problems, I think, more than like number of projects, maybe not so much, but a certain exposure to problems. You were saying, for instance, you've assisted on one film, right?
Yeah, I've only assisted on one film ever. So, you know, I don't know if I'm in a position to answer this from an assistant to an associate kind of a journey, but shoot your question.
No, so purely just want to, what I was saying was that it's probably not even the number of projects that's necessary, but it's ultimately you have to be solving problems. So that exposure to problems is, for me, like when I'm hiring, I need to know how much of that, you know, problem solving you'll be good at as an assistant. Or for that matter, as an associate. What are your thoughts on hiring assistants and associates?
So, you know, you very rightly mentioned something called problem solving. And I always feel editing is not only creative problem solving. In an ideal world, it should only be about the script and the rushes. But the dynamics of an edit room has various facets. So, of course, there's the creative problem solving. There is also the managerial problem solving, which is where your human resource skill, you know, how you are, because there are so many people who have a power equation in, they have the stake in that film, right? So there is also that part of it, you know, where there are producers, where there are actors. You know, actors are now coming a lot more in the edit room than one would want them to. There are actors, there are directors, and now there's Ormax. You know, so there are too many stakeholders there. So there's also a very HR level problem solving. And I would also, the third one I would like to say is stress. We're one of the most stressed jobs in the world. So that's also problem solving, because that's affecting you personally, right? So even though I did assist only in one film, and I think I would have obviously liked to assist more, but I think that's where the film school part, whenever I said about colleagues and friends came into picture. So I was assisting Amitabh Shukla. You know, Amitabh, again, is from FTII. And what I did learn, you know, the volume of work that the editor handles, that was not even close to what we did in FTII. Or in our diploma films, right? And then when that volume hits you, I think that if I would not have assisted Amitabh, I do not know if I would have learned the finer nuances of purely first about management I'm talking about, right? Because I'm still actually following his managerial skills in terms of my workflow, what he taught me. So I think I've borrowed heavily from him as my mentor, as my teacher. And I'm already taking it as a given that you are assisting someone who is, you know, who's a leader, you know, who believes in enabling you. And Amitabh was that editor, you know, he was an enabler. And so he enabled the learning. He was also very consciously, I remember, inculcating all the time that I worked with him. It was about a year. About people management, you know, about what happens when people walk in through the edit doors. What are they bringing into the edit room? What vulnerabilities are they getting? What egos are they getting? You know, all of that. Because we were fresh. I was fresh out of FTIS. So, you know, we to walk with that ego, na, ki, what are you going to tell us? But I think he really taught me a lot about that. And I think he also about discipline, because, you know, 5 years of FTI really shakes your discipline in ways we all know about, right? So to showing up to work, being there, being answerable, all of that, I think I trace back. And I think I was going to work further with him, but a batchmate of mine, a close friend of mine, Avinash, started his film. It was all, I think, great luck happening at our end, and Killa happened, our first film. And hence, you know, I kind of started editing independently. And I would also say that the first few films, having said that, that I assisted, the first few films I did struggle, to manage these various things, because at that time, you know, but I was lucky enough because I was like initially my first 3-4 films, I was only working with friends. So, you know, so even if it was a cottage industry kind of filmmaking, right? So even if things were not going as smoothly, it was okay. But when I think of it, if I was actually thrown into a big film at that point of time, I don't know if I would have been able to handle it then. So I would even treat my first 3 films also as an extension of education with Mitab. And hence I'm saying that assisting is really important, because what if you don't get those first 3 films with friends? You know? I mean, I was lucky. 3 of my friends made a film, but what if they're not? I think what it does, it gives you a lot of confidence if you assist someone. And there's always this person you can pick up the phone and call. So I think give it time. I really want to, a lot of people, you know, obviously approach us, approach all the senior editors. I would just say give it time. And it's not a lot of time. You know, you do not have to give eternity, but just give it enough for you to be sure that when those problems hit you, whether it's creative, whether it's technical, or it's managerial, you are ready. You know, because you don't want to be thrown out of a job. It's hard enough to land a job. Don't get thrown out. So have some patience, and especially, you know, if you believe in the principle of film school. So, you know, it's just an extension of that in the practical world. Spend some time, find the right mentor, and I think it will be a smooth sail after that.
Yeah, and also I feel like currently the workflows are quite fairly structured now, but they're extremely dense. Exactly. Are crazy. Like earlier, we could go on editing for a year, year and a half on the same film. Chal raha hai to chal raha hai. Right now, it's madness.
So I think
deadlines, to be able to even acknowledge and respect deadlines, I think is a whole different skill right now.
And multiple levels of of confirmation on your edit, right? You have multiple people signing off your edits, so you're not only dealing with deadlines. You have these multiple people, these networks and directors and showrunners, and possibly in a commercial film space, you have the actors. A lot of people signing off on your edit, right? So, like I said, that if those 3 friends were not making a film, then to deal with all this would need a lot of metal. It would need a lot of learning and faltering. And I see that quite often, that, you know, that people are in a hurry to land themselves an editing gig, and no harm. But please be sure you're ready to manage it, right? And if you can take smaller steps, they would add up. Right. So do not be in a hurry. Just sit back and see if you can handle it, because those gigs are then converted into, you know, further gigs and more recommendations. So it will happen eventually. But right now it's far worse in terms of everything, in terms of purely the number of demands that are made of editors. It's a lot more. So, but if someone is ready, how can we judge?
True that. But so tell me, as you said, the kind of demands that are made on directors is definitely, on editors, we are doing, other than the edit itself, we are doing background music and sound, graphics to a large extent. It's almost kind of creating a map, a blueprint of the finished product, in a sense. So how are you selecting the kind of work that you want to do? You know you're going to have to put in that kind of effort regardless of whatever you pick up. So how are you making your choices right now?
So, you know, I really feel that there is no straight metric that I feel people should have. Because we are constantly evolving as people, right? So what seems like a right film right now to do, maybe a year later, you know, one would not choose the same films. I think one of the first things that I personally look for is the people, because we spend a lot of time in the edit room with that person, a lot of time, right? So for me, it's very important that the person who I'm going to be working with values me, you know, both as a person and as an artist, right?
So, sorry, just a question, this for also for my understanding, because there's something I really struggle with, to be honest. And I usually find myself giving into, like if it's a good, or what I think is a really good script, or a good, will turn out to be a good film or a good series, I give that importance over the person. And I do also suffer in the long run sometimes. I wouldn't say always, but sometimes. And I do also, because it's happened that I am really excited about the script, but I have an instinct, like a bad instinct about the person. And I'm like, you know, it's such a tough situation to be in. How do you, have you come across something like that? And do you have a particular instinct you choose to follow in such situations?
Actually, the core of all the choices that I make, primarily, even before it's, whether it's the script or the person, is what am I going to learn from this project? And when I say that, I feel like learning can come from all kinds of films. You know, we always think that learning comes only from good films. Learning also comes from bad films, right? And so if for example, there's a genre that I haven't done, or that I haven't been part of, I think look forward to doing that. Because, you know, I want to skill myself into learning the tropes of that genre. So learning then becomes very important. And the learning can only happen if your collaborator is secure, right? So hence comes the second thing, which is about the person. Because if you're walking into a project wanting to learn, wanting to collaborate, wanting to, you know, when you finish the project, having grown, you cannot do any of this if your partner, and when I say partner, it could be various. You know, partner necessarily doesn't really mean the director. I'm talking about the director, producer, production house. If their core value is collaboration, is team effort, is valuing an artist, you know, then it already becomes a plus. So, you know, I'm already walking away with two pluses, and then comes, of course, the other logistics. So I bracket them as logistics, which is obviously budget, your timelines, your deadlines, you know, all of the logistical questions, which, you know, for me comes the third. But I think these two I value the most in terms of choice of the project. And as far as instinct goes, I think, one doesn't know, but I think I've just been touch wood, lucky enough to really work with very, very secure, with people who made the working experience so fun, and in all kinds of things, and in films of mine which have done well, in films of mine which have not done well, in either of them I don't regret that. Oh God, why was I? So I think that has fared well in terms of people, and in terms of scripts. You know, Antra, one doesn't, especially today. I feel, I don't know if you're feeling that way. There's so much uncertainty in the way things are moving forward, right? I think everybody wants to serve market in some way, right? You know, so everything is emerging from the place of commerce. So when that happens, it becomes even harder to choose a project, because here you are coming from, you know, learning this, that, but there is only commerce happening. So how do you marry the two? How do you make a choice then, right? So I would say it's a very case-to-case basis. But I would definitely, I mean, if I were to say something, just do everything, yeah. You know, eat a street side chow mein, go for a gourmet meal, have, you know, chawal dal at home, but just do everything, yeah, because you're going to walk away learning something from each of them. You know, that's the fun for me. You know, I like to do a lot of different kinds of things. Like, I hadn't done a documentary ever. And it's really scary for me. As you know, I think documentaries are really, I think I'm scared. I'm petrified of documentaries. And during the, I think, the last year, an opportunity presented itself to do a docu-series. It was a series called Breakpoint on Z5. Leander and Mahesh, and when that came my way, I was like, I don't know how to do documentaries. How does one do documentaries? I just took a leap of faith, but I'm glad I did that, because I think the amount I've learned on that project, it's huge. So I would say just go for everything. Just go for everything and get paid.
There are these sort of unsaid metrics of failure and success, and a lot of times how much we are paid by productions and how much, you know, respect that one gets is also dependent on these metrics of failure and success. So let's say when box office failure and the, you know, success of a film, then, you know, you also naturally as an editor, anyone who's a part of a film also kind of gets to share that success. Does that come to your mind? Is that something you factor in when you are looking at a script and, or, you know, talking to a filmmaker, and you are willing to put that at stake when you're making that choice to work on that film? Like, let's say you're not sure that, you know, would it be a successful film, or would it be something that may not necessarily work at the box office, but you still want to work on the film?
Right now, in the present atmosphere, I don't know if anyone can really guarantee. What are we looking at as success? You know, you can go ahead and sign a film with someone who had six years of box office success, and you know their film tanks. And then you have something very small and sweet, like Mrs. Chatterjee versus Norway or Unchai, which does so well. So, you know, what is the metric that anybody has right now? I think this is the most confused we have ever been as filmmakers and as people. And that's why I said that what is important is where you are at that. What is it that you want out of it? You know, and your journey has to be yours, right? So if it's money that's your calling, please make those choices. If you're purely looking at that, all scripts should be a 100% great script, irrespective of failure or, you know, success, I'm going to only choose that, then that's also fair. And if you want to experiment across genres, work with different kinds of people, put yourself in uncomfortable situations, then that could be your calling. I say there's no one way about it. But this metric, I really think that it is a burden that's coming, that's falling upon, you know, us a lot. By us, I mean all technicians, all craftsmen, that aapki last film kaun si thi, what box office number has it done. It is constantly, I think. But understand that those questions are being asked purely from a price point point of view, right? Because EPs have a job where they want to negotiate using your previous film. So, you know, either they want to bring down your price, or they want to, you know, like, you be in a better position to argue for a better price. So numbers or performance of a previous film is only relevant for as much. But it should not start dictating you or your choices in a way where, you know, you're only choosing ki, you know, what are the metrics that we make this film a hit? Isme acha hero hai kya? Isme acche gaane hai kya? Because who knows? Who knows? It's a big learning, I think, for all of us. Yeah.
So following from this, another thing that I think we've discussed many, many times is just purely the kind of money that editors make or don't make. And yeah. So I was visiting our institute, and I was conducting a workshop for some editing students. And one of the questions I was asked was, why is it that DOPs make almost triple the amount of money that editors are making? And also, there's an interesting trend where a lot of editing students are moving into production directly after their film course, their editing course. And they are genuinely looking at different, you know, departments of film, not editing specifically, because they realize along the way, and talking to film professionals who are visiting, etc., that editors are not making the kind of money that they should be making, or that these people imagine they should be making. I'm interested in knowing from you what your thoughts are on this.
In terms of why editors are getting paid less, or the way ahead?
Or both.
Both. Oh well, ये प्राचीन काल से ये सवाल चल रहा है. I think you know, we this lament is a long going on, and I think what actors suffer from is high expectation, low paying syndrome. So you know, the world is expected of editors, but the money or the remuneration is not proportional to that. I think that is very clear. It's quite evident. It's very easy that we say that the problem lies with the producers. It's the easiest to say, you know, and we often resort to saying that, you know, producers are not willing to pay us, or you know, like, this production house is not paying us. So, you know, as far as producers are concerned, and when I'm saying that, I'm not justifying it, but as far as producers are concerned, editing comes at a stage where they have kind of battered epic number of shooting days, actors and their entourages, you know, the amount of money they've spent on locations, on shooting it, on right down to bisleri bottles. They've already battled all of that, right? So in their mind, you know, the next set of people who come into the picture, which is the post-production, already has their numbers cut down to really the bare minimum, right? That is understood. I would go a little far and say that a part of the problem also lies with us. And I may have, people might jump at me saying that, you know, I'm blaming our own editing community.
No, but you're 100% right on that.
I'll explain why I say that. You know, Antara, your payment is directly linked to your value, right? And as a community of editors, I feel that we have really undervalued ourselves. Because for an amount of money you quote to do a film, there is always somebody who can quote a bit lower. And it's a double-edged sword. One, you have brought down the whole payment spectrum. You brought down that. And you also, by doing that, convinced the producer or the production that, listen, editing is not such an important job. So it's okay that I'll do it in this much money, right? So you already hit not only yourself, you hit the entire community by doing that. And so this is part one of the problem, that you're undervaluing and undercutting. Part two is actually, I would say, a lack of skill And by that, I mean, going back to one of our previous questions, a proclamation of, you know, anyone can wake up one day and say, I'm an editor, right? And for a producer, what happens is that at that point of time, they could hire that person and realize during the course of making the film that this doesn't work. It's not working. So, you know, somehow our director comes into the picture and they start editing with their assistants or they get a supervising editor on board. And all, the effect of all of this is everybody feels ki editing to koi bhi kar sakta hai. So in a way, you know, wo bhi ek, that's also a problem because we kind of sent out a message that anyone can edit. So combination of all this and a lack of uniform rate card or a lack of exchange of information in a transparent manner, it's all putting us at a disadvantageous position. And I don't know how we would come together as a group, so I don't have an answer to that because you know, we've all been trying together to kind of streamline it. But the editing community is so large. Right, it is so large, and because there are shows, there are OTT shows, there are things getting made in literally every corner of this city. So, how do you cap and get everyone to follow a standard norm? Right, it is difficult. I do not know how we are going to break through ever getting paid, say, the amount that we deserve to be paid. Things have definitely improved. I wouldn't say that it's as bad as it was. But it hasn't improved as much as it should.
No, absolutely. Also, I think at some point we were like, oh, maybe, you know, if editors talk amongst themselves, you know, we can arrive at a figure. Like, let's say if you are quoting for a project and I'm quoting for a project, and we kind of figure, okay, this is the number and we're not quoting less than this. I mean, I've tried that as well, and that hasn't worked either. So
exactly.
You're right that the problem exactly. is with us.
Yeah, I mean, I would like to look at the man in the mirror. It's easier to blame the producer, but I think a producer is there to make his money, and he is the character.
Yeah.
Listen, a producer is staying in the character. He's not he's not going out of it. So I think we have to really take care of the skeletons in our closet.
Absolutely. And I think this thirst for seeing your name as an independent editor, and I'm not only saying it for like younger, newer people, even for established people, like half the time now I'm like, you know, forget it. I won't do it. Like, it can be a really great project, good director, massive production house. If you're not paying me the money and it's not going to be worth my time, I have started saying no. And then I do wonder that shayad nahi bolna chahiye tha. But then it's not worth it. In the long run, it's not worth it.
Yeah, it's not going to financially add up.
It's not. I don't think it's not going to... At some level, if someone is not valuing you, I think you mentioned value as well. It's an indication more than just the money, hard money part of it. It's also an indication of how much that person or that production will value you, right?
Yes. Even with the networks coming in, there was a hope that somewhere there'll be a standard rate. But we've managed to break that. Yeah, we've really...
The fluctuations in budget within a single platform is massive.
Yeah. It's massive. Even within the same show.
Yeah.
You know, there are shows where one editor would be paid hugely differently than the other editor. So, you know, there's also optics here. When I say optics, it's also what you said about successful, in-demand, hit film optics. That is also at play. You know, that is also at play. So one would not deny that that's not part of it. But even even people who fit that optics, even they are not getting paid as well as editors should. So everybody is, you know, some way not comparable to other HODs. I'm not very well aware of other post departments. I believe their condition is as worse as us.
Actually, I think it's worse.
I feel like the amount of time an editor spends on the project, I don't think, say, a sound designer spends as much time.
True that. So, true.
So in effect, you know, when I say, that's why I said huge expectations, low payment syndrome. I think that's very peculiar to editing as a department. And I'm hoping we see a silver lining. When? I don't know.
But tell me, in the middle of all this, what I have understood is that amongst all the very many skills that one must possess as an editor, negotiating your monies is definitely one of the top skills.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. And what would you say, of course, this is a very important skill. What else, what are the other skills that one must possess to be a good and an effective editor?
I think the very first has to be your creative skills of storytelling. Without that, that's a huge umbrella. That's actually your core skill, right? So I'm not getting into the various aspects of what makes a good editor. So I would say the creative skills is your biggest skill, is your biggest, as long as you're strong there, I think all the other skills can be acquired, and the other skills that I feel more so as filmmaking is changing shapes. The second skill is data management. It's really coming to a point where we're dealing with huge amount of influx of footage in quantities we have not seen earlier, right? And to be able to manage it and to be able to go through it meticulously, that I think requires a different set of patience. People are shooting 4 cameras, 5 cameras, all in high speed all the time. That is something that's getting thrown at us and in about every film. And I think how to manage that data together, how to organize yourself, how to organize the project. Because eventually, irrespective of the amount of data that comes your way, your deadline is not going to budge. That stays. That's Bible. All right. So that stays irrespective. So and the third is, which I think is a big stressor today, is how short the working timelines have become. The pressure to deliver an edit, is especially with networks, is so much faster than, it's literally a blink of an eye. You're expected to churn out cuts in a month. Sometimes I wonder if I just calculate the amount of rushes, that itself would take me a month to go through. You know, but one is, so how do you deal with that deadline? How do you create a workflow that you are able to deliver and organize yourself in such a way that you are able to deliver a cut within that deadline? And that's the third skill. Fourth one, I would call a managerial skill. It's huge. It's huge. And when I say managing skills, it's a very vulnerable space. People are really fragile in there. They're tired. They've shot their films in resources which are much more limited than they would have wanted it to be. Probably the performances are not optimal. Probably the script is not working. A release date is coming. Box office is not happening. So now that's another stress added to people. How do you manage all that and stay sane? I think people's skill is becoming more and more important because, in some way, that's a big hindrance in you doing your job then. So people's skill, managerial skill, managing people I think that, and these are things that can be acquired. And the fifth skill is managing your own stress and time, and health. Like, get yourself the right chair. The table has to be a certain size. There should be a certain, way a mouse has to be there. Just start looking out for those things. Because the moment your back is gone, it's not coming back. So start focusing on that. When we're younger, when we get our first film, we've literally worked out of, shady rooms. But start looking out for those things. Have a room with a window. Ask for that. Ask for good food to be served. And it will help you. It will help your body. It will help your mind. And start investing in that at your personal level and also asking production for it. So I would say that all of this, that's a huge set of skills. I might have missed a few, but I think roughly it's a big umbrella.
True. I completely agree with all of these, and especially your last point about looking after yourself. I think that is, if anything, the COVID break has really kind of impressed upon us how important it is to look after ourselves through all of this. But thank you so much, Charu, because all of this has been so enlightening, I'm sure, for everyone who's watching, and also for me, because I think it's so important for all of us to talk amongst ourselves and learn from each other. And which was one of the reasons why I wanted to have this podcast in place, is just so that I can reach out to people like yourself who are so highly experienced and so passionate about what they do. It really helps me, and it kind of helps me move on, to the next day and take a lot of these learnings with me, in my own work and apply them in my own work. So thank you so much for taking time out for this. And I hope to have you back again soon.
And Antra, I must tell you, we are always on the margins, right, as editors. So for you to come up with the idea of this video podcast is really important, because it's also important for the world to see that, these are the people who are shut down in closed doors. And they really have a voice. They really are valuable artists. And somewhere, I think we have a shared journey, both in terms of, and I speak of all editors, in terms of our ordeals, in terms of our success, and in terms of our failures. And I think this really helps everybody to kind of come together in a way. And I'm seeing a lot of it, with the collectives, with editors meeting more often, with editors taking time out for each other. So even though we've not reached there yet in terms of our value monetarily, but there is a lot more emotional support that we have from each other in the community than it was a few years ago. And thanks to technology, and thanks to people really I think coming out of their dark rooms and sharing their issues. And as for the younger editors, I would really urge you guys that use this opportunity, use this time that you have to acquire skills, to meet with good editors, to meet with senior editors, and share your problems. Everybody I know, and I speak for a lot of us, is there to help. So thank you, Antra. I think it's a really, really, really great gesture.
Thank you so much, Charu. Thank you.
If you enjoyed this video, then please like it, share it, comment on it, and subscribe to this channel so you're tuned in for our upcoming episodes.